Hi, I am Martín Rodríguez Redondo. I'm director of Marilyn. I came from Argentina. Bueno, creo que me fue bien. Tuve, por suerte, el apoyo de el director de fotografía y el director de arte, que eran amigos, y también de la coach de actores. Y formamos un equipo muy unido y trabajamos juntos como en todas las decisiones.
Well, I think it went really well. Luckily, I had a big support of the director of photography, such as the production designer and the casting supervisor, which are all friends of mine, so we really made a great team.
Y creo que sí fue difícil el tema de que era una película de bajo presupuesto y tuvimos pocas semanas de rodaje, y bueno, y eso fue lo más desafiante de todo.
And I think the hardest part was that we had a really low budget and just like a couple of weeks to shoot the whole film, so I think that was definitely the hardest part of it.
And it says that it's based on a true story, and this narrative sets in rural Argentina. I was wondering, how typical is this for LGBT, how typical a story is it for LGBT people living in rural Argentina, or Argentina more generally?
El caso sucedió en 2009, el caso real sucedió en 2009 en un pueblo a unos 80 kilómetros de Buenos Aires, de la ciudad principal. En realidad yo pienso que el caso es una excepción, pero la violencia contra las personas gays y trans, tanto en ambientes rurales como en ciudades pequeñas, es muy común en Argentina y en otros países de Latinoamérica.
So the real case happened in 2009 in a little village about 80 kilometers away from the capital, from Buenos Aires. And I think this case is an exception due to its violence, but I think it's still very common that there's discrimination against trans or homosexual or LGBTQ people in Argentina.
Creo que, o sea, lo especial del caso es que normalmente las personas gays y trans son víctimas de esta violencia, digamos, y en este caso es una persona que, además de ser víctima, se convierte en victimario.
So I think the special thing about this case is that usually LGBTQ people are the victims, but in this case the person is not just a victim, he's also the one,
perpetrator.
Exactly, the perpetrator, sorry.
Okay, that's fine. And how did you go about researching for the film? So have you spoken to a lot of trans or LGBT people in Argentina, and did you have any contacts with anyone involved in the original
Sí, entrevisté a la persona real, a la real Marilyn. La entrevisté varias veces. Ella me contó su historia desde que nació hasta que sucedió este hecho. Y me contó también, bueno, todo lo que sucedía con los hijos del patrón y la gente del campo. Y también conocí a otras personas vinculadas a la historia real, como amigos y vecinos, y los entrevisté a todos ellos.
So, yes, I was in touch with the real Marilyn, who's now in prison, and I had a couple of interviews with her, and she would not also tell me about what happened, also about the whole story with the landlord who's in charge of the country, of the land where they're living on, and of the neighbors and the family. She would tell me a lot about it, and I also made interviews with other people that were involved in the case. Yeah.
Y también ella me dio un diario que había escrito, que eran 10 páginas de donde contaba su historia, y se llamaba El sufrimiento por no ser igual. Y a partir de eso yo empecé a trabajar el guión. Y después sí me entrevisté con otras personas trans, digamos, una actriz trans que es relativamente conocida en Argentina, que va a trabajar ahora en una película de Santiago Bolosa. Y ella me ayudó también a entender el proceso por el que pasa una persona trans en su adolescencia.
So also I was working with an intimate diary that Marilyn gave me, which is 10 pages long, where she describes about what happened, where she describes this crime, and this diary was titled Suffering from Not Being Normal, which is also like basic script. And then I had this interview with another trans actress who is really well known in Argentina. Yeah. She's going to film right now with a director called Santiago Olosa. Olosa is correct. And she also helped me to understand what a trans or gay actor must go through in Argentina.
And the actor that you had playing Marco Marilyn, so that was Walter Rodriguez, yes? And I wondered, does he have any experience with trans people, with LGBT people?
Him as a director, you mean?
No, sorry, the actor.
Yes. Oh, the main actor.
Yeah.
Yo quería saber si el actor principal tenía experiencias de trabajar anteriormente con personas LGBTQ o si estaba ya involucrado, digamos, en la escena.
Okay. No directamente, o sea, pero él tenía una libertad para aproximarse a eso en sí mismo. O sea, quiero decir, cuando envió las fotos para el casting, estaba maquillado y era muy libre en cuanto a cómo se vestía, digamos, él hacía su propia ropa y utilizaba elementos que no eran propios de varón, entre comillas, ¿no?
So no, he hasn't had like formally experience by like acting as an LGBTQ person, but he was very freely himself as a person, like by the way he dresses, and also when he was sending the pictures to the casting, like he sent pictures where he was wearing makeup, and he had this very like flamboyant style of choosing his clothes, etc.
Entonces para mí fue importante verlo y conocerlo porque para mí tenía la verdad en el cuerpo que yo buscaba para el personaje de Marilyn.
So for me it's very important to get to know him before, because he had something that for me was a certain truth on with his own body that was very similar to the character of Marilyn in the movie.
And in the film, something that I really loved was how tenderly some of the scenes were shot with Marco and Marilyn and the clothes that she starts to wear and she starts to make and she's experimenting with. But when the mother finds those clothes in Marco's bedroom, she almost treats it like it's alcohol or drugs or something that's so abhorrent. Why is it that clothes are something that's so important to people in terms of identity, and why do they challenge patriarchal attitudes to such an extent? Entonces,
creo que lo importante es entender que en una sociedad machista, digamos, como la Argentina o otras latinoamericanas, nos enseñan desde chico a ocupar un rol que es o hombre o mujer, y el hombre se viste como hombre y la mujer como mujer. Es un pensamiento binario, digamos.
I think something really important to understand that in macho societies, just as Argentina is, since you're very little, people tell you how to dress and what belongs to man and what is female. So like also by clothes is very defined that this is male and this is female.
O sea, es blanco o negro, no hay nada en el medio, ¿no?
So it's just like black and white, there's nothing in between, there are no like grayscales.
Entonces creo que usar ropa de mujer para un hombre es desafiar esa prohibición tácita que existe en la sociedad.
So I think if a man, by using women's clothes as a man, you're kind of like playing and you're kind of trying to get to the limit of this prohibition of like stretching out these limits that are so like predetermined by society.
Y lo que pude observar en los carnavales, yo fui varias veces en el proceso de investigación, es que en los carnavales es el momento en donde eso se relaja y se permite que las personas gays o trans se vistan de mujer y son aceptados y como parte de un show y como algo divertido.
And also what I noticed that I've been to a lot of carnivals on my research and I figured out that there like there's suddenly there's this limit does not exist. It's the only way how like trans or LGBTQ people are allowed to be freely in the way how they dress because it's okay during carnival. Like this is the only time of year where they can, let's say, be free and it's not as strict as the limitation of what is male, which is male and female by how you dress.
And it's at the carnival where sort of Marco finds the identity of Marilyn and we have this song going on in the background. So it seems like clothes are such a big aspect to the way that Marco finds the
Así que dice que es en el carnaval donde él empieza a vestirse así y escucha ese tema que como se crea para él su propia identidad de Marilyn. Entonces sí, la ropa es muy importante para que él pueda empezar a crear su identidad.
Claro. Sí, sí, yo creo que Marco es un personaje que está como en un proceso de autodescubrimiento y de entender lo que quiere ser, digamos. Y se está creando a sí mismo. O a sí misma, diría, digamos, en un futuro, pero justamente no se le permite ser quien quiere ser.
So I think Marcus is right in the middle when we see the movie. He's in a process of self-discovery, like, and also of like a self-creation of who he wants to be, which is Marilyn.
Yeah.
The mother, going back to the mother's behavior, so much of what she does is upholding these patriarchal attitudes. But she herself suffers underneath them. So her family is struggling to survive because there is no male head of that family. Why is it that women uphold the very laws of gender and patriarchy under which they suffer?
Okay. Creo que es mi forma de verlo, pero pienso que las mujeres son parte, una parte importante en reproducir un sistema patriarcal y machista, digamos.
Well, it's my point of view, but I think women are in many ways part of reproducing this patriarchal and macho system by the way they act.
Las madres, digamos, sobre todo, y lo he visto, digamos, en madres de chicos adolescentes gays o trans que mientras lo que su hijo haga, digamos, y lo haga en función de ella, está bien, está permitido, pero cuando eso implica una decisión propia de su sexualidad, digamos, eso incomoda.
So I've also seen this a lot by mothers of teenagers who are gay or LGBTQ, that they were not, as long as their kids were like, let's say, act out homosexually or being like queer dressed or whatever, that it would be okay as long as they allow it, but as soon as they get out of like the mother's law, they won't be able to accept that if it's a known decision of the child itself, they will not be able to accept it.
Y también me interesaba algo del caso real que tenía que ver con una madre que parecía ser más machista que el padre, digamos. Y eso me parecía interesante para romper un poco con ciertos clichés de que el padre es la figura represora, digamos, en general en las sociedades machistas. Y en este caso era la madre y el padre parecía ser más abierto con la elección de su hijo.
Also, what I find interesting about this particular case is that in this case, actually, it's the mother who is a lot more into this macho society. The father seems to be a lot more liberal when it comes to his son and like his son's decision, while she is actually the one who's supporting the system, this patriarchal system.
And do you think that the family is under quite a lot of financial strain towards the end of the film? And do you think the issue of poverty and that pressure? Do you think that affects the mother's attitudes towards the homosexuality, towards the transgenderism?
¿Vos pensás que la pobreza, que se nota sobre todo mucho al final de la película, es una influencia en las acciones de la madre?
Sí, yo creo que todas las acciones de todos los personajes creo que están condicionadas también por el entorno en el que viven y por las situaciones por las cuales están pasando.
Yes, I think most of the actions of the characters that we see in the film are also due to the circumstances where they live in and due to the events that are happening along the movie.
De alguna forma creo que hay una ambigüedad en la madre, que es que no sabemos bien si es que le prohíbe vestirse de mujer porque necesita a un hombre en el campo, a que se haga cargo del campo, o porque también sabe el sufrimiento al cual está expuesto en ese contexto en el que viven.
I think there's also an ambiguity by the mother's reaction when she finds his clothes, because it could be that she needs a man after the father's death that like helps her out with the country, helps her out with all the hard work that needs to be done, or because she's afraid of what could be possibly happen to her son in this environment by being openly gay.
Yeah.
Pero creo que sí, ella es la que lleva adelante una acción más contundente con respecto a que su hijo ocupe el lugar que tiene que ocupar. Es la que ella ejerce la ley, luego de muerto el padre, digamos, es ella la que toma el rol de obligar a su hijo a hacerse cargo del campo, pero por una cuestión de una presión social y del patrón.
But I think it's also that it's mostly her decision, which is usually actually the father's decision, that she's deciding about what her son has to do, which in her opinion is that he needs to take care of the place where they're living and working, also because that's the only way how they can deal with the landlord.
Y lo último es que eso tenía que ver con que para mí la idea principal de la estructura de la película era la idea de un acorralamiento, y era que es una familia que es acorralada por su patrón y por el pueblo, y un chico que es acorralado por su familia.
And I think it's also about a lot of acorralamiento es como represión, ¿no?
Sí, podría ser, sí, pero también es como sí, no sé cómo, qué otra palabra.
Claro, estoy buscando otra palabra
okay.
En español.
Bueno, entonces sí, usemos represión.
Ok,
sí.
Perfecto. It's also, I think, that there's a certain, what's another important subject in the film is this whole, like, repression that there is on one side from the family that the kid should be the way they want him or the way they find it correctly, and also of the landlord that the family will pay the rent and be like functional and be something that's useful for him, that they would keep this, the country they're living on.
And talking about that repression, something that is really noticeable in the film is that there's just this silence for so much of it. There's very little dialogue, there's almost no music. We just sometimes have the sounds of the countryside in the background or the motorbikes rolling. And it seems like even at these moments of incredible tension, so in instances of sexual violence or after the father dies, there is just this blanket silence. And I was wondering, is that a reflection on the lack of communication that there is about these topics in Argentina, or rural Argentina particularly?
Sí. Okay. Yo creo que fue más bien una decisión artística, digamos, para mí, que era tratar de que los diálogos no explicaran los comportamientos de los personajes, sino que los comportamientos hablaran por sí solos, o sea, y a través sobre todo de las acciones y de las miradas.
I think it was more than nothing for me, an artistic decision to incorporate so many silences, because I wanted that the actions are based on what people are doing and not what they're saying, more like on who they are and how they move and what they're doing in the film, and not about the dialogues that they're speaking to each other.
Y también porque me interesaba el personaje de Marcos como alguien que no dice lo que le pasa, va callando todo el tiempo lo que le sucede, va acumulando ira, enojo, dolor, y explota hacia el final.
I think also, especially coming to Marcos, it's like that from the fact that he never speaks out, what bothers him, like all this like anger he has inside of him, or also he just doesn't speak about his emotions, which also then leads to this violent end. Yeah, it's just like an outburst that happens in the end, also because he remains everything for himself.
Pero también me parecía que era importante no destacar ninguna acción, que ya eran bastante traumáticas y violentas, con música incidental, por ejemplo, y eso también fue una decisión artística de que los hechos hablaran por sí mismos.
And also that I didn't use that much music was because I didn't want to make a lot of actions that happen in a movie, a lot of scenes. I didn't want to make them even more dramatically, unnecessarily. I think they speak for themselves and they don't need this like to like highlight them even with more like sound effects or music on them.
Yeah. Y por último, bueno, los silencios para mí tenían que ver también con generar una tensión entre los personajes sin explicarla, ¿no? O sin evidenciarla, sino como trabajar sobre lo no dicho.
And also I think that the silence creates a very special tension between the characters, and I was interested to work with the silence about everything that's not said and unspoken. Yeah.
Because so much of it is in the looks between people often. Yeah. You can get a lot from that communication. Mm-hmm. And more in the artistic techniques of the film, the editing I felt conveys so much of the emotions, the unsaid emotions in the mm-hmm. film. So we move from very, very intimate shots, so for example of Marco with Federico in kind of very intimate relationship, and then to a shot of Marco with his family with a lot of physical space and distance and not talking. And that sudden cut from tenderness to isolation or from violence, whatever it might be, conveys a huge amount of the emotions. So what was your decision making behind that?
Okay. No, que ella decía que le llamó mucho la atención en la edición de que hay como contrastes muy, muy fuertes, uh-huh. de que saltás de una escena en que Marcos está con el novio, uh-huh. en una escena íntima que se intercambian cariños, y después saltás a un espacio en que los personajes están alejados, que casi no se tocan, que están en los bordes uh-huh. del encuadre. ¿Cuál fue tu decisión en la edición? Como que, ¿cómo pensaste, okay. cómo te planeaste la edición?
Sí. La idea era, de alguna forma, que el montaje fuera muy seco y cortante, digamos. Para mí eso tenía que ver con sí reflejar cierta observación que yo había hecho en el campo de cómo es la vida ahí, digamos, que tiene que ver con que, por ejemplo, muere el padre y la vida continúa y hay que seguir trabajando y los personajes tienen que hacerse cargo de lo que sigue.
So I wanted to keep the edition like very dry and very harsh also in a way, because I think that's also reflecting after I was like looking at those places how life in the countryside is in Argentina or in rural areas, because the same as when the father dies, like there's no big deal about it, it's just life has to go on and it's dry and it's no big emotion, it just keeps on and goes on.
Y también creo que tiene que ver con los contrastes que me interesaba trabajar entre distintas situaciones, como decías, de violencia y después de silencio, o de algo amoroso y de algo más duro, tenía que ver también con que me interesaba reflejar de alguna forma la personalidad impulsiva que tiene Marcos. La voy a retomar, pero, o sea, para la traducción, como que lo que me interesaba era que la estructura narrativa de la película de alguna forma fuera tomando o reflejara parte de la personalidad de Marcos, que tiene que ver con que él actúa, digamos, y que sus actos a veces son impulsivos e incomprensibles, que esto tenía que ver con cómo llegábamos a ese final, digamos.
And also what I wanted to show with this editing is the contrast of the situations that we're finding also, like that which is really like what we're seeing in the movie, is the story of Marcos or Marilyn, which comes between like loving and caring, beautiful situation of intimacy between him and his boyfriend, and then the next shot is with the family, it's a coldness. And I also thought that it was quite similar to Marcos, like to his personality, this way of editing, that he's like very impulsive, and sometimes often like cutting, as you said before, and that maybe also that this kind of editing would make you understand how it comes to this dramatical end of the film.
And talking of contrasts, I thought the role that technology and like mobile phones and that kind of communication plays was a really interesting and innovative aspect of the film. So Marco's kind of trapped in this very rural world, very family orientated world, and then actually with his phone he's able to communicate with Federico, he's able to talk to Laura. There's a whole different world almost being lived through the phone, and then when the phone is taken away, he's completely trapped, and that leads to the violent act towards the end of the film.
Mm-hmm. Entonces ella decía que le llamó mucho la atención el uso de los celulares que hay en mm-hmm. la película, de que Marcos está como en cierto sentido muy atrapado en uh-huh. su entorno rural, pero del hecho de que tiene el celu le permite que pueda hablar con Federico, que pueda uh-huh. hablar con Laura, y que también después ella piensa que guió a que la madre le sacara el teléfono, uh-huh. que esto fue como el inicio de este violento final.
Sí, pienso que Marcos vive en una condición, Marcos y su familia viven en una condición de aislamiento bastante grande, y que su única forma de comunicación con el mundo exterior es su teléfono celular, es lo que le permite llevar adelante su sexualidad y también llevar adelante sus amistades.
So I think Marcos and his whole family, they're living in this very like isolated situation. So his phone is definitely the only way how he can like live out freely his sexuality and his friendships, etc. So it's definitely very important for him.
Creo que es parte de es su vía de escape o su forma de o es su última o sea, es importante en sobre el final porque es su última herramienta como para comunicarse con el exterior y para comunicarse con las personas que él quiere.
And I think also that his phone is kind of like his tool of escape to this whole like locked-in environment and isolated environment where he is. So when they take it away from him, it's like they cut off the cables to the outside world.
Como la gota que rebalsa el vaso.
And it's just like the drop that makes the glass be fill over.
Porque finalmente él se siente finalmente totalmente atrapado en esa situación.
Because without the phone, he feels even more locked inside the situation
yeah.
where he's in.
And they literally can't leave the house as well towards the end of the film.
Y que al final de la película tampoco pueden salir de la casa, claramente.
Exacto. Sí, la idea era que fuera como totalmente claustrofóbico esa situación, donde lo dramático es que para mí de la historia era que nunca podían dejar esa casa, ni la familia ni él, porque finalmente la película termina con él dentro de la casa.
So I think this is definitely like the last scene where they're so locked in. It's also something a very dramatic aspect of the movie because they never managed to get out of this house. They never like managed to leave this house as much as they try, but they just and in the end they just stay in there
atrapados.
Locked in.
Trapped, no?
See, locked in.
Ah, okay, I'm
yeah. We keep alluding to the ending, and I don't want to give it away.
Okay.
But I feel like we do need to discuss it a little bit. It's completely unexpected. It's incredibly dramatic, and it is violent. And I wanted to understand how you read that action.
Mm-hmm. Sí.
Perfecto.
Creo que, o sea, siempre me interesó. No trabajar con una estructura lógica, digamos, porque creo que alguien que comete un acto como el que comete Marcos al final no puede ser entendido desde una lógica.
I was very interested in working with a structure that's not logical because what happens in the end you cannot justify that with any logic.
Pienso que quizás estamos acostumbrados a que ciertas estructuras narrativas, cinematográficas, es más como una convención cinematográfica, creo, el hecho de que una acción y otra acción llevan a que alguien haga un acto violento, cometa un acto violento, más que formar parte de una acción de la realidad.
So I think it's also that we're very used to in cinematographic language that we're always expecting that one action leads to another. And not as maybe something bigger, it's just like one comes to the other, and as he said before, he was not interested in working with this logical structure. Mm.
Pero también creo que hay una situación donde quizás en términos psicoanalíticos se llama pasaje al acto, que tiene que ver con personas que se sienten como atrapadas y durante años de humillación y maltrato, y la única forma de salirse de ese lugar simbólico que ocupan ya sea en su familia o en el lugar donde sea es a través de un acto violento.
And I was also interested in this psychoanalytical term which is called pasaje al acto, which I guess translates to like a step to the action, which happens a lot when people were suffering from being repressed for many years. And then live in situations where they even get used to this repression, yeah. that they see that the only way out they have of the situation is by a violent act. Okay.
y creo que sí, también podría entenderse, digamos, yo no quiero condicionar, digamos, la lectura del final, digamos, pero podría entenderse también como una cierta distorsión de la situación en la que está viviendo, digamos, a partir de todo el sufrimiento que fue viviendo, toda la opresión que sintió, y donde para él, para su subjetividad, él está completamente excluido de esa familia, digamos.
And I don't want to give it like just one way of interpretation of this last situation, but I think it's also a distortion that happens like inside of him, that he just feels like completely excluded of the situation where he's living in, of his family.
Yeah.
And that leads to it.
Bueno, y creo que también hay una situación donde, o sea, para mí el final es muy trágico, digamos, porque la única forma de salir de esa familia es destruyéndola y destruyéndose también a sí mismo.
I think also there's something very tragical in the end, because he sees as the only way to get out of the situation is by destroying his family and with this also destroying himself.
Porque creo que no hay, bueno, no hay nadie que pueda cometer un acto como el que comete Marcos que no sea afectado en su subjetividad, digamos.
Because I think it's not possible to commit a crime or an act as he does if you're not like affected in your own subjetividad and like your own awareness, your own way of, you know, how you see things.
Okay. Hey. Creo que...
Thank you so much.
Muchas gracias.
Really, really interesting. And yeah, enjoy the rest of the Berlinale.
Okay. Thank you.
And yeah, thank you for your wonderful film.
Thanks.